Well, I'll pay Jason for me.
Either he wants to say something or eat something, one of the two.
Take the opportunity to put on musical interest.
Acting, dancing, and now singing a Grammy winner.
Back to those movies, and particularly Night Shift, and Gung Ho.
Really? Never knew that.
Welcome to Just Talkin'. We have a great show today, a great hour special this evening, and we are going to be celebrating Racine. So, as you know, we're celebrating our 25th anniversary of the Just Talkin' show. So this time we're going to celebrate Racine, since we did many segments throughout the years. Great people here, great community, great downtown as we're here in downtown Racine. But the first video segment we're going to go to is the EcoFest that we do every year at Gateway Technical College in Racine. They have great booths out there, great to inform the community on the environment. So let's go to EcoFest at the Gateway Technical College in Racine. We are at the EcoFest in Racine, and I'm with your name?
Rick Fair.
And Rick, what booth are we at today?
We're with the Hoy Audubon Society. We're a local chapter of the National Audubon Society, and we represent both Racine and Kenosha counties.
For those who want to get involved in Hoy Audubon Society, you gotta go on bird walks, do you have lectures, what do you guys do?
We have monthly meetings, first Thursday of every month, where we get a guest speaker usually. We have a lot of bird walks throughout the year and field trips, especially during the month of May. We have, that's the month when all the birds are migrating. So we have bird walks at four different locations at four different nights or days during the month of May.
And where are those locations?
In Racine, Cliffside Park on Tuesday mornings. Wednesday, it's Colonial Park in the evening at 5:30. Hawthorne Hollow in Kenosha on Thursday at 5:30. And Riverbend Nature Center on Friday mornings at 9 o'clock.
Why should someone come to one of these bird walks?
Well, we're a good, friendly group of people. We enjoy teaching people about birds. And a lot of people like birds, but they don't know what they're seeing. And this way here, we can help them identify birds.
And if someone wants more information, is there a website or anything?
We do have a website. You can go to hoyaudubon.org.
Okay, here we are at EcoFest in Racine, and what's your name?
I am Melissa Warner.
Melissa, what booth are we at today?
This is the BEAM booth. BEAM stands for Bat Education, Awareness, and Monitoring.
Well, let's hear a little bit about education about the bats. Now, people don't realize there are bats in the southeast of Wisconsin, correct?
There are at least six varieties of bats that we are located in the southeast part of the state. Three of them are more common than the others.
Wow. What are the different types of bats?
The most common ones are the big brown bats, the little brown bats, and the red bats.
And how do the bats play a role in the environment?
The bats eat a lot of insects, which is nice when you're out in the evening and you don't want to get bitten by mosquitoes. They keep the mosquito population down, but they also eat a lot of other insects. Many of those insects are agricultural pests, and so that's some agricultural pests that farmers don't have to spray for if the bats eat more of them.
Are they around all year, or how does that work?
Bats are here only in the summertime. Usually they start arriving about April, and by the end of September they are gone. Some of them migrate to a warmer location and are active all winter. Others hibernate in old mines and in caves.
I see also at your booth you have some sort of monitoring device. What's that?
Yes, in cooperation with the Wisconsin DNR, we monitor the bat populations here in Racine. We have teams that go out hopefully four times during the summer. They walk with this wonderful little monitoring device that we have a half hour after sunset for an hour in a specified route, like Colonial Park or Chute Park or Riverbend or Pritchard Park or Elmwood Park. And the device hears the bat, which we can't hear. Their frequency is too high for most of us, and it translates it to a lower frequency so you hear it. And it shows a little picture, a sonogram on the screen, and then you save it. And at the end of the hour, my sweet spouse Jay will upload all that data, take the data, and then upload it to Madison. And they use it along with the data they're getting from all the other agencies that are doing this around the state that helps them do their planning for bat protection.
Well, we do have another area that you are involved in, so let's go on to the other side of the booth.
All right.
Okay, Melissa, we are on now the other side of the booth, and what booth are you representing here now?
This is a group called Weed Out Racine. We are a 501c3. We work very closely with the City of Racine Parks, Cultural Services, Recreation, on removing and managing invasive species in our city parks and other places.
People don't realize that these invasive species, invasive plants, they just happen, like the garlic mustard, too.
Yes, garlic mustard, buckthorn, honeysuckle, multiflora rose, Dame's Rocket, teasel, phragmites, I could keep going.
So do you guys just pull the weeds out or do you spray something on them?
We do a number of different things. A lot of times, the woody ones get cut and stump treated so that they don't grow back. Ones like garlic mustard and Dame's Rocket, we pull. We have pulling parties and get lots of people to pull them to keep that population down. Then there are some like the reed canary grass, which is a grass, so it has a very dense root system. You can't pull it. And cutting it, just like grass, it just keeps growing back, just like your lawn. And that does have to be sprayed in order to get rid of it. Here we have information for people, also information about the ongoing work in Colonial Park. The Colonial Park was, the ash trees were decimated by the emerald ash borer, which a lot of people have heard about. They were logged, the dead ash trees were logged out about a year ago, and the city's been pulling the stumps and the slash. We're replanting trees. We're having a big replanting day for this year in October, I think it's 26th, whatever is the 4th, whatever is the Make a Difference Day. We'll be out planting probably 600 trees. And last year we did 400 and we were finished early. So this year we're going for 600 or more.
Do we have a website or Facebook page here?
We do have a Facebook page for Weed Out Racine. And there's an exclamation point after the Weed Out Racine. So that may help people find it.
Sounds good. Great organization, helps the environment. And thank you so much for coming out to this event today. Okay, welcome back, and we thank Gateway Technical College for that great event at EcoFest. Moving on, we always highlight nonprofit organizations, and there's many nonprofit organizations in the city of Racine, and one we went to was TechCore Wisconsin, and that was Executive Director Michael Pitch we talked to, gave a great tour of their facility, and once again, TechCore Wisconsin would take computers that needed to be refurbished, and they would do that by volunteers from students in the area, and then those computers would then go and be sold to or donated to the other nonprofit organizations. So it's a great organization was TechCore Wisconsin. So let's go to that interview. Racine at TechCore Wisconsin, and I'm here again with Mike Pitch, Executive Director here. Let's talk about TechCore Wisconsin itself. What is it?
Well, we're a 13-year-old nonprofit organization that our mission is to bridge the digital divide by providing computers and internet service and training to people who traditionally don't have access. So we work with schools, we work with nonprofits, we work with low-income families. So we run a store which is open to the general public where anybody can come in and bring a computer and buy a computer. We also do repairs for the general public. We do recycling of computer equipment, which is fee-based. We do training, both group and individual one-on-one training. And we have other services for schools and nonprofits like off-site data storage and on-site support, IT support and management. We have a limited supply of laptops. Laptops are very popular and they don't last here very long. And we have less inventory now than we typically do. The computer business here is surplus computer equipment from corporations. So these are not residential computers that people drop off here. They can drop off those kinds of residential computers that they bought in the big box store or whatever and are not using anymore. And we recycle those for a fee. This is corporate surplus. These are computers that come out of corporations, government operations, medical institutions, hospitals, and so forth. And so this is a higher quality unit.
And see what we got on these shelves. What's now? This is just for display only, sort of like a museum type?
Yeah. This is our TCW Computer Museum. This is here because the stuff comes through here, and it's a bit of history, so we don't want to throw it all away. We cherry pick out some of the more interesting things out of here. And for a lot of the volunteers here, whether they're high school kids or college kids, this stuff is older than they are. So it's a little history lesson for them as to where this computer industry came from. A lot of people don't know there was anything before Windows XP. Well, there's a lot of computer history that happened before that, and there's some of it that even happened before my time.
Yeah.
This is a 8-inch floppy disk. And this is just a little bit before my time, and I've been in this business 22 years.
And it would hold how much of comparable?
It holds 128 bytes, so it would probably hold one page of a letter. Okay. A one-page letter, roughly, is what they're here. So they can come in and look at the $100 computers. This is a starter system. This is a first-time computer user system. Okay. So these are people who have never had a computer before. These are senior citizens that buy these. These are parents that buy these for elementary school children to do their homework, those types of things. The $100 and $150 computers have value for that. Some of those types of computers we also end up putting in labs, in preschools and daycares and things like that, for the kids to work with in groups of four, six, or eight, or however many children they have. And then, as you can see across the back, there are stacks of computers that are finished and ready to go. Those are the types of computers that go into computer labs. Those silver and black compacts there, for example, we just put 50 of those into St. John's Lutheran this spring in a computer lab and in the classroom. So we also build some special application computers too as well. Like this dual screen monitor here, this is for video editing or audio editing. Yeah. Occasionally we get someone in who's looking for a special purpose higher end computer. Most of our market is lower end. It's $300 and less computers. But we have a market that is in the 4, 5, 6 and up at lower volumes, but they're looking for those types of computers as well for special purposes.
Now, when you say starting system, is it loaded with Windows XP or some operating system?
All computers are loaded with Windows XP. They're loaded with an Office program for word processing, spreadsheet, and so forth. The lower-end computers below $200 use OpenOffice, and above that they use Microsoft Office. So you have Word and Excel and all of those programs. Also includes antivirus software, anti-spyware software, and firewall software. This is our accessories. This is where you can buy bits and pieces for your computer, either for a do-it-yourselfer or somebody who just, spilled coffee in their keyboard and they need a new keyboard. Okay. So we have keyboards and mice for $5. We have modems and video cards and cables, networking cables and power cables, and also upgrade pieces. Like optical drives, CD and DVD burners, and those types of things as well. And then something fairly new to us is also the networking and server business. These are network servers that are used in a business environment. So we also have products here not just for the residential customer, but also for the small business customer and the entrepreneurs that are starting their own business.
Okay, now this looks familiar because I remember at the other place you guys were at, there was a training room. Maybe you could explain a little bit about that.
Yeah, actually at our old facility we had two different training labs which we used over the course of the 9 years that we were over there. And that, due to the change in the nature of the organization, became a little bit too much capacity. So when we moved in this facility, we built this particular room here out of the open space and made it a 12-unit lab, because 12 people at a time is plenty to do group training with. I mean, we did some classes of 20 and more in the other building, but that's a big group to work with at one time. So So we do individual, in here we do individual one-on-one training. We have five different classes that we offer to customers, and they're $25 a piece, or all five for $100, buy four and get one free type of thing. And then we also do group training. So organizations, nonprofit schools, and so forth that want to bring a group of people in here for training, we do that as well. Or rent out the training lab to allow them to conduct training programs in here.
And let's talk about, once again, do you have a website?
We do have a website. It's www.tcw.org. And there's information about our specials. It's information about the types of nonprofit work we do. And it's a historical document that will take you back 13 years and show you everything we've ever done that I've had time to put up on the website.
And a phone number?
You can reach us at area code 262-619-0931. And on email at info@tcw.org.
And for those who want to stop by here at the Tech Corps Wisconsin, the address?
Again, we're at 2051 Lathrop Avenue, which is the old Aldi grocery store, and which is at 21st and Lathrop, in behind the Family Video Store.
Well, Mike, I wanted to say you do an excellent job here at Tech Corps Wisconsin, and the whole organization is just terrific for the community. And thank you very much for talking to us today.
I appreciate you coming out, Jason.
Welcome back, and once again, we thank Mike Pitch from Tech Corps Wisconsin here as we celebrate Racine on this special Just Talkin' show. Moving on, one of a great family business here in Racine, Wisconsin is none other than SC Johnson. And we were out there. They gave a great tour for us at the SC Johnson. So let's go to that interview. Okay, here we are at SC Johnson at the Golden Rondell Theater, and I am with your name?
Greg Andreg.
Greg, nice to see you. What role do you play here at SC Johnson?
Well, I'm the Director of Global Community Affairs for SC Johnson, so responsible for how we engage in the communities in which we operate around the world.
Okay. Well, for those who don't know about SC Johnson, what is it?
Well, SC Johnson is one of the world's largest manufacturers and marketers of consumer products for the home. And has been based here in Racine for 127 years, founded here in 1886.
Now, it's a family business, correct?
That's right. We're one of the largest family businesses in the U.S. and now in the fifth generation of Johnson leadership.
Wow. And let's talk about, there's some products. So when we walk into the Golden Rondell, there's some products that SC Johnson makes. Maybe you can highlight some of them?
Well, sure. We have a number of products that, that we manufacture, and we put a display here for visitors to see. Products like Raid and Off, Pledge, Ziploc, Scrubbing Bubbles, Glade, and a variety of other products that we market around the world.
Okay. Now, this is the world headquarters for SC Johnson?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right here in Racine, world headquarters.
Okay. Do they actually make the products here as well, or are they done elsewhere?
Well, we have a manufacturing plant about 7 miles west of here. It's our largest manufacturing plant in the world, and we manufacture quite a few of our products for North America here. But we also have manufacturing facilities around the world.
Now let's talk, there's a theater upstairs, which is just a phenomenal, and let's talk a little bit briefly. When we walked inside the theater, it's sort of like a global type of architecture. How is that made?
Well, the Golden Rondell serves us as our guest relations center here in Racine. It actually was originally built in New York for the 1964 and 65 World's Fair, where we showed a wonderful film called To Be Alive, won an Academy Award in 1965 for Best Documentary Short Subject. We moved that back to Racine and put it here on our campus, opened in 1967. And actually, we still show To Be Alive here, so people can still come and see it.
Okay. Let's go on in the theater and check it out. We're inside this magnificent theater. Again, what goes on in here?
Well, first off and foremost, the Golden Rondell serves the company as a corporate meeting facility. But we also like to use it to entertain visitors that want to come and visit the company. And we sometimes refer to the Golden Rondell as being sort of like the living room of Racine. Because here we provide a variety of different types of programs that we think are of interest to the public. First off, we show films here that are for our general public visitors. They're shown on Fridays and Saturdays during the summer months, and then at other times during the year. These are award-winning films that are of general interest to the public. Well, this is, we're standing in the middle of what's known as the Great Workroom, which was part of the administration building designed by Frank Lloyd Wright and opened here in Racine in 1939. It's one of the best known buildings in the U.S., and we get a lot of architects and architectural students, as well as the general public who come to visit us. So we bring them here so they have an opportunity to see this remarkable space that Mr. Wright designed for the company. What you see as you look around is this kind of large, wide open space supported by these extraordinary columns here, what Mr. Wright called dendriform or radical calyx columns. They were designed to hold about 60 tons of weight, and the intent was to be able to not have interceding walls holding the ceiling up so you could have this wide open view and vista of the great workroom.
And even right down to the unique chairs, could you talk about the chairs?
Well, Mr. Wright also felt that it wasn't just important for him to design the building. He wanted to design everything that went into the building. So all the furniture that we use was designed by Mr. Wright and incorporated in the building in 1939 as well. So there are desks that sort of mimic the building, and then it has three levels. This building has three levels. And then he designed chairs that were pretty extraordinary for their time. They were originally three-legged chairs, although over the years they were modified to be four-legged chairs because three-legged chairs turned out to be a little unstable.
Again, this room is just amazing, and also the elevators. Maybe we could talk a little bit about that. I'm looking at it. I'm describing it. Let's hear all about that.
Yeah, well, they're hydraulic elevators, which means that they're piston-driven rather than pulled by pulleys up and down. They run from the basement to the third level of the building. As you can see, they've got a lot of brass on them, brass enclosures. Our employees fondly call them the bird cages, but they allow a very nice panoramic view of the great workroom as you're traveling from floor to floor.
Okay, this is probably the most, another interesting part of the tour that we really didn't talk, we just kept saying his name, Frank Lloyd Wright. Well, let's get to the part of the tour. Who is Frank Lloyd Wright?
Well, Frank Lloyd Wright is probably America's most celebrated and renowned architect. Right from here in Wisconsin, grew up in Spring Green, Wisconsin, and lived most of his life either there or in Oak Park, Illinois. And frankly, fundamentally transformed American architecture as we know it today.
What was so special about his architect?
Well, he believed that America required American art, and he felt that many of the designs that were prevalent as he was coming of age were really European designs that had been brought over here. But he felt that the wide open spaces of the prairie called for a unique architecture, and that's what he spent his whole life trying to do, create that kind of architecture.
So what are we standing in here?
Well, this is called the S.C. Johnson Gallery, at home with Frank Lloyd Wright. Frank Lloyd Wright, for his entire life, wanted to really reinvent and make a difference in American homes to make the home better for American families. And there's a great tangential connection to S.C. Johnson because the products that we make also make homes better for families. So it's a natural that we would, on this campus, spend a little bit of time exploring how Frank Lloyd Wright, in fact, tried to make that difference with American architecture.
So how did S.C. Johnson and Frank Lloyd Wright get together? Was it a phone call? Was it a lunch? What made this happen?
Well, in the 1930s, the company was growing, and Mr. Johnson knew that we needed a new administration building, hired a local architect, but that didn't work out the way he wanted to. So he dispatched somebody to Chicago to find another architect. And after interviewing a lot of architectural firms, finally one exasperated architect said to him, "If you're really looking for something out of the ordinary, you're probably looking in the wrong place. You probably want to go to Spring Green, Wisconsin in your own backyard and talk to Frank Lloyd Wright." Mr. Johnson called, arranged to go up and visit, and the rest is history. We do. We have a Frank Lloyd Wright library and reading room that has over 400 volumes of works about Mr. Wright and his architecture that we make available as a study spot for anybody that would like to come and learn more about Mr. Wright. The exhibit is open free to the public, and we encourage people to come. Here you'll be able to see exploded models of Frank Lloyd Wright Usonian homes so that you can understand the architecture. You'll be able to see examples of furniture that Wright designed for mass consumption. You'll be able to see some of the, and explore some of the ideas that Mr. Wright had for not just remaking homes, but remaking whole cities, what he called Broadacre City and the living city that he proposed in the 1930s and 1950s.
Well, all I have to say is a 4-star rating on this tour. It's just the architecture, the information, the history. Frank Lloyd Wright, just top notch. And for those who really want to get the full experience again, how do they get in contact to get on a tour?
Well, we encourage them to go to our website, which is www.scjohnson.com, and there they'll be able to find information about all the things that we offer for public visitors, and they can make reservations there as well. Or they can call us at 262-260-2154, and we hope everybody comes and visits.
And then also the Golden Rondel, they can go on the website as well for that.
Exactly right. Yeah, exactly right.
And the address here at SC Johnson?
Well, it's 1525 Howe Street, but actually people, when they're coming to visit, will want to go to the Golden Rondel, which is at the corner of 14th and Franklin Streets right here in the south side of Racine.
Well, once again, Greg, absolutely terrific tour. It was a great time of letting us see the inside of the tour of the SC Johnson, and thanks so much for talking to us today.
Well, thanks so much for coming.
Welcome back to Just Talking, and we thank Greg Endergreg for that great tour he gave us at SC Johnson. Moving on, one great area here at the city of Racine is none other than the Racine Zoo. Racine Zoo has been a terrific zoo here in the community and the surrounding areas. Come and visit the Racine Zoo. Beth Heidorn, who does an excellent job creating also the events. She's the executive director out there. So let's go to the Racine Zoo. Okay, here we are again at the beautiful Racine Zoo here, and I'm honored to be here with Beth. And Beth, you're the executive director?
Yes, sir.
All right, Beth, let's see. Well, now you're not a newcomer anymore. You've been here a while, and you got things going great and everything. Yep. But for those who don't know about the Racine Zoo, what is it?
We are 28 acres of a wonderful zoo park setting. We have 77 species here of everything from orangutans to rhinos to fish and everything in between. So we are open 7 days a week. Right now our hours are 9 in the morning until 6 at night, and we have lots of things for all ages.
Terrific. And especially in the summertime here, there's a lot of activity too.
Oh, yes. We've got events coming up on Saturday. We've got Zoorific Saturday, and it's all about being a zookeeper because it's National Zookeeper Week right now that we're in. We just started that. And we're also highlighting our tigers. So it's going to be Tiger Appreciation Day too.
And we always have the famous in the background here, like castle. Maybe you can explain what this is.
Yeah, it's called Vanishing Kingdom. This building has been around since 1936. It was the first building that they built when they said, oh, well, if we're going to be open year-round, we should probably have a place for animals to go inside in the wintertime. So that's the reason for the building. And right now that houses our orangutans, our white-handed gibbons, our Arctic fox, our inside lion space, our emperor tamarins, and of course below in the basement it has got all of our animal ambassadors that we take out to schools or nursing homes, birthday parties, that type of thing. And on the top floor is our education area.
Okay, Beth, I'm always just amazed that always there's something new and in the Racine Zoo, keeping it fresh and active. And let's hear what we have behind us.
Yes, what we have behind us is a fennec fox. It is the smallest of all the foxes. It has nice big ears. We can show you a photo of it. Right now it looks like Zorro is taking a little bit of a nap. It's, you know, it's a Monday afternoon, and that's okay. It's got to have nap time. But this, what we really like about this new exhibit is we were able to bring some of our animal ambassadors from, when we just talked about the castle, the animals that live down there that go out to places. So Zorro's an ambassador animal. So there'll be times where he actually goes out to a birthday party or the hospitals or things like that. Oh. And it will have a sign here that will say, hey, I'm out visiting the nursing home. So it's just another way for us to bring some of our animals up that are not always in programs, but people can see them, and people love Zorro. He's been a big hit, and it's like an affinity exhibit. You can see our eastern black rhinos right through the glass as they're walking around because that would be their natural for those two to live near each other.
This is perfect, because I think that movie Zootopia had a fox or something. That'd be perfect for the kids, you
yes.
know. But so where does it all come? Do they find an ad in the paper that Zorro is available, or where do you come across of getting a new animal?
Yeah, so we work with the AZA, which is the Association of Zoos and Aquariums, and we work with their SSP programs, which is called Species Survival Plans. And so it's like a dating service a little bit for animals. So we'll put in that we have Zorro and he is looking for a mate. And then it goes into this big database, and all the zoos and aquariums around us that are accredited will go, oh, well, we have one that we don't need, so let's work a deal. And they'll call us, we take their animals, they may want something we have, and it's a good loan and exchange programs within the zoo and aquarium community.
Okay, Beth, once again, thanks so much for showing us around at the Racine Zoo. It's a great place to go in the summer, actually all year round. But for contact information, where are you guys located, website and Facebook?
Yeah, we are located at 2131 North Main Street in Racine, Wisconsin, 53402. We are right on the corner of Main and Gould, which is a great spot. We're not too far from the beach or downtown. And our website is www.racinezoo.org. And our general line, if you have any questions, is 262-636-9189. And there's someone to be able to help you on any one of those challenges, or just send it to info@racinezoo.org, and we can answer any questions people may have.
So come on down to the Racine Zoo. Beth, thanks so much for talking with us today.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Jeff Daniels. Want to play? I first picked up a guitar 30 years ago, and what started out as a hobby quickly became a way of life. Playing music isn't about perfection. It's about fun and self-expression. See how you can get started at wantoplaymusic.com.
Welcome back to Just Talkin' as we're celebrating Racine, and we're here in downtown Racine, Wisconsin. Musical group that we loved highlighting was the Sand Carvers, and Tony and Carla Gwynn was I met at one of the benefits, and they came on our show. After that, they said they had their band Sand Carvers. They came on the show. Great band from Racine, Wisconsin. They came into our studio. So let's go to the musical segment of the Sand Carvers.
Thank you.
welcome back to Just Talkin' as we're celebrating Racine. One thing we always do is we highlight the Miss Kenosha Scholarship Pageant, but as we know that there in Racine, Wisconsin, there's also a Mrs. Racine that they have a competition for as well. We got to do a Zoom interview with Mrs. Racine, Louisa Chukalski, so let's go to that interview.
That is correct. I am Mrs. Racine for the United States of America.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Louisa, for joining us today. So let's talk about it. How did you hear about the pageant? And where did that all start?
So how it all started is I had a girl an acquaintance that I went to high school with who I knew was very active in the pageant world. And she got a hold of me. I want to say it was probably around January last year. I had started a new job. I didn't have to take call anymore. And she got a hold of me on Facebook and had asked me if I was interested in doing a pageant. And, you know, we get all these weird invitations on Facebook. So I thought it was a fake invitation. I'm like, is this girl serious? Because I've never done anything like this before. And I responded to her and I was like, sure, I'm interested. And then all of a sudden my Facebook posts just started going crazy. And I was like, oh, this girl is serious. I was okay. And I looked at my husband. I said, well, what are your thoughts? You know, and he goes, yeah, go ahead, give it a try. What I didn't know about pageantry is all the service that came with it. That was a whole new world to me. And that is probably the one thing I've enjoyed the most about all of this is I currently do Habitat for Humanity and I am a Girl Scout co-leader. And it's all about giving back to the community. And each and every one of those pageant girls that are up there have a platform that they stand for.
And what was your platform?
My platform is volunteerism. It's finding more time to give back to people. And in the return, what you get back for yourself is just pure joy, the happiness that you give back. And in today's day and world, it's hard to detach yourself from some screen of some sort and to think like, oh, how could I ever squeeze in the time? And I find time. You find time and it's a good feeling to give back.
Well, maybe those who don't know about Habitat for Humanity, what is that program?
So the Habitat for Humanity actually has two programs. And one of them, the easiest way to get involved with the Habitat for Humanity is their ReStores. And how that works is they break down homes and they call them deconstructions. So they go in there and I believe it's only $400 that they'll deconstruct a home from you very nicely. They'll take down the lamps or anything that you're doing and they can sell those products in their store. And that 100% goes back to the Habitat for Humanity. And how that does, all that money that goes back to the Habitat for Humanity funds the homes that they build for people. And the people that build these homes are people who have never been first time, you know, homeowners, people who might have struggled to get money from a bank to buy a home in today's day and world. And it's always kind of been the American dream to own a home. That's how you know you've made it. And it opens up so many doors when you do open a home or own a home. So these kind of things opens up a lot of doors for these people who wouldn't be able to have these opportunities.
Well, let's hear it. What was your reaction when they called your name?
It's surprising because you're up there with so much talent and so much drive to know that you're being recognized and that you're the one. Your reaction is, and so all the time, every single girl, when they do that, they go, it's true.
Then what happens after that? Do you speak at certain groups and activities? Let's hear what happens after you get crowned.
Yes. So after you're crowned, Mrs. Racine, you go about and choose your platform or whatever. If you already have a platform, like I said, mine was the Habitat for Humanity. Getting more volunteers for them, putting the word out there, how to get involved. I mean, the Habitat for Humanity has been around for a very long time, but people, it's one of those things like, yeah, I've heard of that. And it kind of stops there. They don't know how to get involved. So it's giving people the knowledge on how to get involved is truly, and getting more volunteers, which in return gives more people for the Habitat for Humanity to build their platforms.
Well, what about the, the dress or the gowns. Is there any sort of specific things that you have to wear?
Oh yeah, those gowns. Drama, drama, drama. They like big gowns, big hair, big, you know, flowy capes. And that was probably the one thing I'm like, where does one even go? Right? Where do you go to buy a dramatic gown like that? There are all these, I can proudly say that every single dress I've ever worn has never been brand new. It has been, they have all these resale shops. There's women who have had pageantries and they have all these consignment shops, and the consignment shops are really where the fun is. It's all the dressing up is all the fun and the jewelry, all that wonderful stuff.
And for Miss Racine, is there a website or any Facebook or social media that people can look at?
You can find me on Facebook. I am more of a Facebook girl. With my regular Facebook, I also have a Facebook page for Miss USOA, Miss Racine, and you can find me there as well.
We thank you so much for talking with us today. We congratulate you, and we look forward to seeing you at Miss Wisconsin and Miss USA. So thank you so much for talking to us today.
I appreciate your time as well, and hopefully the next time we do chat, you can say I'm Miss Wisconsin.
As a parent, I know one of the most important times to be with your children is when they aren't feeling well. For many families, there's a place they can go to find the support they need.
Ronald McDonald House Charities programs provide that supportive environment so families can be together while their children are dealing with serious illnesses.
You can volunteer your time at a local Ronald McDonald House or drop your change in an RMHC canister.
Today is a great day for all of us to show our support.
To find out how you can get involved in your community, visit rmhc.org.
Okay, welcome back to Just Talkin' as we're celebrating Racine. One great event that they have, which is in downtown Racine, is the Racine Memorial Hall. And we actually went to a great event, which was called It Came From Lake Michigan. And we've always covered Comic-Cons, Expos, film festivals. And they were doing one here in Racine. It was called It Came From Lake Michigan. Had great guests, great movie stars, and we had to interview two of them, and that is Sophia Smirnova and Eddie Deason, who you probably remember from the Grease movie. It was here in Racine, Wisconsin, so let's go to those interviews.
It came from Lake Michigan event, and I'm honored to be here with Sophia. And your last name again?
Smirnova. Thank you. It's an honor.
Oh, it's an honor. No, I tell you. And what do you think of the event so far today?
I am so impressed. I mean, first of all, when I got here, I read the program. Promptly at 1 o'clock, we had the How to Make a Zombie. And then around 4 o'clock, you know, how to do the fighting scenes, you know, how to put the fighting scenes together. This is actually the very first film festival that I've been to where it's very interactive. You know, not only the customer can go in and meet their celebrities, but they have actual classes that they can take home with them. And what's even great is that you have two universities here that are involved, and students are inspiring to do films or get into film. They, you know, they get a first hands-on experience from the independent filmmakers, you know, how to make a zombie or fighting scenes or how to fund a project, what kind of music to pick, shooting location. I mean, it's amazing. I'm so impressed. And the best part is they have belly dancers in there. Aww. I'm like, Wayne!
Exactly right. Now you've been to other conventions before. Where have those been?
My very first horror convention is Fangoria back in March, and then the second one I did was Flashback. Fangoria, I did not expect to get into film. I was there promoting my artwork, and I ran into producers and directors, Amy Lynn Best and Mike Watt, and they just thought, oh, you know, we'll give her a shot. And from there, you know, I did my very first horror movie with them, which is coming out next summer.
Mm-hmm. And what's it going to be called?
It's Abattoir.
You're absolutely beautiful. Let's talk about your modeling. Is modeling very competitive these days?
Extremely competitive. Honestly, when I got into horror film, independent horror film specifically, I thought of changing my career because modeling is good business. It's very lucrative. Specifically for me, spokes modeling. That's where my main source of income is because I do a lot of promotional modeling, guerrilla marketing. And glamour modeling is very competitive because I have a lot of girls in California that are competing with me, and what's hard is like I'm part Asian, and in the Asian scene it's really hard to get your career off. So there's a lot of cattiness, there's a lot of, like, when I first got into modeling, glamour modeling specifically in LA, I get a lot of threats from, you know, girls telling me to stay away from the area, stay out of the territory. And so when I got into horror, I there's a lot more comfort. Like, everyone here is more, they're more family-oriented. You know, you feel like you're working with your friends. It's not just being cutthroat and trying to drive each other out of the market. So it's a very, very different atmosphere for me. And I truly love it.
We'll definitely look forward to your artwork and especially for your horror films as well. And thank you very much for coming to the event. Thank you very much for talking to us today. Racine, Wisconsin at the It Came From Lake Michigan event, and I'm honored to be here with Eddie Deason. Nice to see you today, sir.
It's my pleasure. My pleasure.
Thank you very much for coming to the event. What do you think of the event so far?
It's been fun. It's been great. Hopefully we'll get more people tomorrow. It was kind of a small showing today, but everybody I've met has been so nice. The people out here are wonderful. Yeah. Very gracious. Everybody's been so friendly. At the restaurants, everywhere I go, the people are so nice. Yeah.
You did such action movies, and everybody remembers you from Grease. How was it being in that film?
Oh, it was awesome. That was my very first job. I got to work with Travolta. Everybody was great. It was like a two-month party, the greatest party ever, and it lasted 2 months. It was awesome. We just had a reunion, you know, about Grease. John and Olivia weren't there, but most of the rest of the cast was there, and they re-released it on DVD.
How did you get involved with the movie?
It was a pretty big cattle call. I went in. It was Alan Carr, who unfortunately has passed away. Randall Kleiser was the director, and Mr. Joel Thurm was the casting guy. I went in. I was auditioning for Eugene, and I went in, and it was a good audition, okay? Then I went back home, and they said they cut the role out, so I was real depressed. So, believe it or not, as corny as this sounds, my agent and I went to church. We lit some candles and prayed. And then they called back the next day. They said, we're putting Eugene back in. We want Eddie to play the role. So that's how I got it. So it was a religious epiphany. Yeah. Yeah.
Did you ever think that movie would get this so big? I mean, when it came out?
Yeah, isn't it funny? I think it's the most watched movie of all time, especially with teenage girls. Young girls, I see, they watched it 60, 70 times. But yeah, it's like a classic. Yeah. Yeah.
What's one of your favorite parts in the film?
When I get hit with a pie, definitely. Because that's my big scene. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I remember you in War Games as well.
Yes, Mr. Potato Head, yeah, Matthew Broderick. I think that was Matthew Broderick's first film. Yeah. We would drive to the set together. He was sad, I remember, time because his father had just passed away, James Broderick, but he was a very nice guy. And I remember I kept forgetting my lines, and Martin Bress was my director. He gave me cue cards, first time I used idiot cards, and they have my lines written. Oh, that's a data encryption algorithm, and I read it off the idiot cards, yeah, yeah.
Well, you work with an excellent film director, Robert Zemeckis. How is
the best? He's my favorite. He's like a father to me. I Want to Hold Your Hand was his first film, and that was the first film Spielberg ever produced. And I knew Zemeckis was a genius from the word go. And then he wrote 1941, with Steven directed, and then he remembered me 25 years later and wrote me into Polar Express. So I really like that. He's God to me, Zemeckis. He's better. I love Steven Spielberg. He was great, but Zemeckis is the best. I think he's better than Steven anybody. Zemeckis is the greatest director that ever lived. That's my viewpoint. Yeah.
And why is it? Because you work with him.
Well, he knows comedy. I think Steven is great, but I don't think comedy was his thing. You know, 1941 was his only comedy. And he's, you know, his movies have funny moments, but he couldn't necessarily do a whole comedy. Whereas Zemeckis is such an ear for comedy. And if you look at I Want to Hold Your Hand, it's such a good movie. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And he captured that 60s and the whole Beatles phenomenon. Yeah,
George Harrison saw it, and he said he really liked it. So I like that.
Really?
Yeah.
I did watch The Polar Express.
Oh, thank you.
Phenomenal movie. And your part as well. What did you think of it when it was all done?
It was wonderful. It was motion capture. We go in every day. Tom Hanks, Peter Scolari, Nona Gay is Marvin Gaye's daughter. We go in every day. We put on scuba suits. They glue bathing caps to our head, and they glue 152 dots to our face. And that every day we went through that process, and then they'd have laser cameras around the stage, like 60 laser cameras, and they'd shoot us from those. And so it was really weird. We'd act out the scenes, and they'd have kids do the scene after. They had kids for each of us, four kids, and they'd morph this into the kids. You know, the kid, it was our movements, but they made us into little kids. It was really a weird experience. Yeah.
So any upcoming things that you're working on that
hopefully
we could...
Polar Express 2, I hope. wouldn't that be great?
Wonderful.
Yeah, I'll be a millionaire, but I hope. But I don't know if Tom wants to do it, but that would be my dream. I'd love to do that. Mostly right now I'm doing voiceovers. I do a lot of voiceovers, cartoons and stuff, Cartoon Network. Yeah, yeah.
Well, we thank you again, Eddie, for coming on down. You do excellent work as always, and thank you very much for talking with us today.
You. You're a very nice guy. Thank you. It's nice to meet you.
Here at the Shalom Center, we provide wraparound care for Kenosha's neediest families and individuals. Our goal is to assist people facing difficult circumstances regain stability by providing food, shelter, and nursing care. We give immediate help based on need and support them in regaining their independence. By working with many congregations and organizations, we make the best possible use of community resources. Come join our wonderful staff and volunteers and become part of the Circle of Life.
Welcome back as we're closing up the show here in downtown Racine as we are celebrating Racine this full hour. And we're going to leave with the last interview, which was just amazing, was Fred Hermes, who was a resident here in Racine. Unfortunately, he passed away recently, but we were able to go into his house. Believe it or not, in his house, you go into his basement underground, he built a wonderful old-time theater. And if you don't believe me, watch the video segment, and we'll be here next week, 8:30 to 9 o'clock, and we'll roll the closing interview. We are here in Racine, Wisconsin. A good friend of mine to stop by Fred Hermes' house to see what he has to offer here for the Just Talkin' Show. So let's follow me. Actually, I think we're going to go on it. So why don't you follow me, see if Fred. I see Fred in there. All right. And this is my good friend, Fred Hermes. Fred, thank you so much for being on Channel 14, Just Talking. I heard you got a lovely home here today. Very nice living room here. I hear there's something really neat in the basement. Maybe we can go down there and check it out. Okay. Yeah, I know every house has usually a basement, and you know it's got, you know, in case for whatever reason a tornado or something. You got some nice pictures here on the wall too, and just a nice house you got here, Fred. I appreciate you letting us come down here. And Fred went even down further into his basement, so we'll go ahead and follow him. So come on with us. And as I'm going down the steps here, you can see some great nostalgia, some Laurel and Hardy pictures as well. So now we're coming down here. So, Fred, just really nice basement you have here. And this is really nice. You're a Phantom of the Opera, so you're a fan of that movie?
That's him, the original film. 1925 version.
People always associate the Phantom with the organ, which is really neat here. Yeah, so, but just a beautiful lobby area. So let's go on. I think there's a main room here in the Fred's basement. And as we come in here, all right, as we're walking into the main room, Fred, it looks like you have a 1920s organ / theater. Is that correct?
1926 organ. It's from the 1920s. They're all from the 1920s.
All right. So, Rick, if you could pan over this. So what we're seeing now is that, Fred, it looks like you've constructed a underground old-time 1926 theater.
Right.
This is fantastic.
Thank you.
Okay, so we are in the basement home of Fred Hermes. And, Fred, I'm just still in awe of this. It's surreal. Let's get a little history of this. When did this all start?
Oh, about 1959, I started building this basement. Okay. And the basement is 20 feet deep, and it was four bare walls.
So in 1959, did you know that you were set out to build a old-time theater downstairs?
I set out to build a room that would hold this organ and be large enough so it would sound good acoustically. I did not intend to build a theater at the time.
Okay.
Because none of this stuff was available at the time.
And then when was the basement area completed?
Oh, about 10 years ago.
Really?
Bit by bit.
Bit by bit, okay. Now I'm looking across the room, and you said there are pieces from other theaters in here?
Yes.
Which theaters?
Well, there are the lights underneath the balcony, and the lights on the side are from the Lake Theater down in Kenosha. The chandeliers here were made from the wall brass. You see that fixture on the way down on the stairway?
Mm-hmm.
That's two of those put back to back, and they are also from the Lake Theater. And the crystals hanging on there are from the theater down in Chicago that was torn down, the Piccadilly Theater in Chicago that was torn down.
Did you seek a consultant out to build this?
No.
Really?
Mm-mm.
Are you a craftsman by trade?
No, I'm in the real estate and insurance business.
Then how many seats do we have here in the theater?
Roughly speaking, 150.
Okay.
Including the balcony.
And have you had groups here? Or?
I've had tour groups coming from here from over 40 years.
Wow. Now, I know you have the love of the organ here. Let's tell us about that.
The organ came from the Michigan Theater in Detroit. And I bought this in 1955. And moved it here in 1956.
Wow.
And this is the console, what you see, what you play at, that's called the console. That's the smallest part of the organ, although it weighs about 2,500 pounds. The whole organ weighs, roughly speaking, 25 tons. And we moved it here. It took two big moving van semi-trailers to get it here from Detroit. And the basement is built in the shape, or the whole house is in the shape of a T, like Tom. And at that one column there, the wall goes back about 20 feet, then it goes 30 feet that way again, then about 75 feet this way, and the other side the same way. And then there's an organ chamber in that section, and one in that section, and two more behind me, behind the grill here. And then there's also a relay room in the corner, which looks, it's a two-story high relay room full of relays, which is looks like a small telephone exchange, and that's where all the connections are made between the console and the pipes.
Okay.
And then there's a 20-horsepower blower in the other corner that produces the air for the organ.
Let's talk about the projector, so you can show movies here as well.
That's right.
So, and that's what we saw, those 16-millimeter films, 8-millimeter films. So you have the projection room up above, and right. It shines on a screen down.
Right, that's correct.
Okay, what's one of your favorite movies?
Well, everybody likes to see The Phantom of the Opera. It was Lon Chaney from 1925.
When you show silent films like The Phantom of the Opera, is there certain pieces that go along with the movie,
no,
or do you just play
you improvise it.
Improvise it.
Because
okay.
You have to, when the mask comes off, you got to play a tremendous chord. And I really had the people really scream about that. When that was shown in Chicago in 1925, they actually had nurses in the aisle because people would pass out from that scene where the mask is ripped off his face.
Well, I don't think there's another place like this ever. Has anybody else accomplished something like this?
Not exactly like this, no. Other ones have big organs in a great big room, but nothing but looks like a theater.
Well, once again, Fred, this is just an absolutely tremendous theater that you have in your basement. Great organ as well.
We call it the Bijou, Basement Bijou.
At the Basement Bijou here in Racine. And once again, if you want to learn more or come down and see this great Basement Bijou, is contact the Racine Convention Bureau, correct?
Racine County Convention Bureau.
Racine County Convention. Well, we'll close with Fred playing a little organ music and maybe a little bit from Phantom of the Opera. And we want to thank you for tuning in. We'll be here next week, 8:30 to 9 o'clock. And Fred, take it away.